Hi, I'm Janelle Smith. This is Nancy Jaffe. We are the registered dietitians at the UCLA Digestive Health and Nutrition Clinic. Today, we'd like to talk to you about the low FODMAP diet, which you may have heard of. It's becoming very popular. FODMAP stands for an acronym that is fermentable oligo-dimonosaccharides and polyols. So these are actually five different sugar categories that are found naturally in foods that are not very well digested or absorbed in the first part of our intestine, so they end up traveling through the rest of the intestine untouched until they get to our large colon. While they're traveling, they tend to pull water with them, which can lead to a feeling of fullness. And then once they're in the large intestine, they serve as food for our gut bacteria. And this is a very normal, healthy process. There's nothing bad about our gut bacteria fermenting our leftovers, right, but they do happen to produce gas as a side effect. Painful. Yeah, so for people who are very sensitive to this gas and distension, we know that the low FODMAP diet can be very helpful at reducing symptoms up to 75% of bloating, diarrhea, some constipation, and some mood changes and fatigue that's associated with those symptoms.
Great. And so is this it?
These are the high FODMAP foods. These are the five different sugars, lactose, fructose, fructans, galacto-oligosaccharides, and polyols. And as you'll notice, these are in so many of the common foods that we eat in our daily life. Milk, yogurt, apples, and honey, onion and garlic, which is in so many things when we dine out, especially wheat, and so many different vegetables that we can actually naturally find these sugar alcohols in as well.
Yeah, so it's really important to work with a dietitian if you're going to follow this diet, just because it can be hard to remove these things on your own. The other important part is it's not meant to be a long-term solution. So what we usually recommend is an elimination phase where you remove all of these foods for roughly a 2 to 6 week period of time. And then we try and bring them back, right? So we go through a reintroduction phase, which is very structured and very specific, where we're taking each sugar category one at a time. And we're actually seeing how our patients' bodies respond to it. Mm-hmm. And then the end result is we move on to phase three, which is called maintenance, or I like the word liberation, because it means that we figured out what was causing symptoms and we get to open up the diet by only keeping out the foods that were actually problematic, or maybe even giving certain supplements and enzymes that can help to break down some of these sugars so they don't cause the symptoms, and we get the most open diet with the least amount of symptoms. So that can be really nice for our patients.
Yeah, so it's not a forever diet, but it can be a very effective temporary diet that we love to work with our patients with.
Absolutely. So we hope you'll come and see us in clinic if you have interest.